Our whole lives are synthetic. We get up by the clock. We go to work at 7:15. We get on the motorways. It should be you wake up when you get up in the morning. This is what everybody wants. Whenever the hell you get up, you go to school. It's open 24 hours a day. You go into the school, and there are no processed foods because we don't need it. It's good to have foods that aren't processed with certain types of chemical agents that might be irritating to man. It would be good to have food that isn't contaminated and water that isn't chlorinated. But it would also be good to have an attitude that isn't polluted, an attitude about life, the attitude that prevents you from becoming ill in many areas. And this is what the attitude is called. It's called looking for justice. You get it from religion. Give all the world all the best that you have, and the best will come back to you. Oh, isn't that wonderful? That's so full of shit. Jesus did it, and he got crucified fast. Gandhi. If you give all the world all the best that you have, whatever comes to you comes to you. Not the best. That's a lie. Religion would have to learn how to tell the truth first. And the truth is essentially this. Whenever you talk to people about things that are different than that which they've come to accept as right and normal, they feel uncomfortable and tend to dislike the source. What is right? What is wrong? What is good? What is bad? There may be no right, no wrong, no good, no bad. But there may be an optimal pattern of conduct for human beings. And that's what I believe in. I believe that there is an optimal pattern of conduct that humans have to agree upon, not obey. Anytime they say, you obey me, that's dangerous. But when they say, there's so much water in the land, and there's so much salt water moving in, salt water intrusion, and we have to do something about that, that concerns us all. That's the kind of knowledge that's useful to us all. We must have knowledge about human beings and their behavior and their values. If you see a child brought up in great scarcity, a very weak child, and there's just a jar of cookies, and the big brother's going to grab it, and look, he can never quite get a cookie, and they give him a little crumb, throw it his way. This kid is always eating crumbs. Any place he goes, he eats a little bit of cookie on the restaurant table. And you see a kid in a restaurant, see somebody eat, and he picks up the little crumbs and eats them. He says, oh, that's disgusting. But if you know what shaped his behavior, you say, that's interesting, that a human being can be brought up with such deprivation as to commit or do a thing like that. And what we have to do is change the whole basis of raising children. And that means taking them away from parents. Not by force. Through television, good music, radio, and say that these new centers have people that love kids, and they do. And these people will work with the kids, all of them, put their arms around all the kids, and they work there because they love kids. And I said the furniture is small, everything is reduced, so the kids can have their kind of life. So by raising children together, slanty-eyed, fat, short, tall, and no grades, merely additional instruction where needed. Now we want to make it possible for people to have such a rich, fulfilled life, a music room, an art room, so many places to go, so many things to create, so many things to do, that you never say, I don't have time. If you gave a person 9 days off, they're like, oh, crazy, you gotta go back to work. They haven't even learned how to enjoy leisure. And so we have to teach people in school how to find meaning in your own life first, before you study anything, how to relate with other people, how to sense the water in the fields and the wind and trees, to walk through the forest and smell things that are alive and touch things that are alive, handle snakes and fish, and just run your fingers through the water just for the feel of it. Climb a mountain and look at the vast view and rivers, watch the sun setting and clouds, the feel, and then try relating with other people. And after you can do that, then you become a technician, an artist, a typist, a stenographer. But first you have to learn how to live. But they grab these little girls and they teach them how to cook and wipe the baby's ass and type, and they have no lifestyle of their own. And so they work in an office 8 hours a day, the best years of their lives. And the brain, by the time they're 60, there's nothing but because they don't have anything else. There's not a school in existence anywhere that teaches you how to find meaning in your own life when you're very young. And that's the most important thing, love of life.